to America's native spirit. It has heritage, it has craftsmanship, it has authenticity.
Fierce family loyalties.
The Beams, we do one thing, we make whiskey.
Centuries of tradition.
Our family's been doing this since 1795. Hell, the United States ain't that much older than us.
And the relentless pursuit of perfection.
We're all competitive and want to push back and make sure we don't go away.
No Halloween fright could ever equal this real-life nightmare.
I've never seen anything like it. It's unreal.
I have never seen anything this big.
A river of fire.
This is the little-known story of Kentucky bourbon and how a devastating act of God tested one of the oldest industries in America.
All anyone can do is watch, wait, and wonder what this means for the small community that's made a way of life from the bourbon in its warehouses.
When people think about bourbon, they definitely think about Kentucky. My name is Marianne Eves. I am Kentucky's first female master distiller. Special water that we have in Kentucky is most important for the fermentation process. Our water here is very mineral rich. It's because of the limestone in the bedrock. And then there's the soil. It's got a lot of nutrient content. So the corn and the grains that we grow here is unique. And because bourbon has to be at least 51% corn, it makes its mark on the product.
Today, 95% of the world's bourbon is produced in Kentucky. It's an industry as old as America, with a history riddled with hardships and heartache. One of bourbon's earliest pioneers is German immigrant Jacob Boehm, a man known today as Jake Beam. In 1795, he used corn to produce his first bottle of bourbon, or Old Tub whiskey. It becomes a roaring success. The bourbon industry booms as the early United States pushes westward and continues to thrive during the Industrial Revolution. But all that progress is derailed in 1920 with the enactment of the 18th Amendment, Prohibition. The liquor, wine, and beer industry shuts down. By now, the Beam family business is managed by James Jim Beam, who has no choice but to shutter the Old Tub family distillery.
I'm Fred Noe. Jim Beam was my great-grandfather. I'm the seventh generation of Beams to be involved in the bourbon industry here in Kentucky. And he made enough money to keep food on the table and keep the family surviving during Prohibition. But the day Prohibition was repealed, at the age of 70, Jim Beam applied for a license and opened up the old Murphy Barber Distillery where we're located today here in Claremont.
After more than 12 years of Prohibition, Jake Beam's great-grandson, Jim Beam, names the new distillery after himself, and one of America's most beloved brands is born.
Start here with Jacob Beam. He comes up as David, and David, Jack, and Joseph.
Beams, we do one thing, we make whiskey. Look at the family tree spread out all through the bourbon industry, because all the good distilleries had Beams making the whiskey.
But while the Beam behind the brewery changes, the classic recipe remains true to Jacob Beam's original batch. And it's all made possible by one all-important ingredient, yeast.
The yeast goes back seven generations. It goes back to Jacob Beam. He brought it over from Germany. And then it just got handed down generation to generation. My last name's Beam. That's an indication. So we're still working off that same strain of yeast.
Of Jacob Beam's descendants, 30 have been distillers operating in North America, and they've all developed at least 40 different brands. The Beams are only one of the famous families in the bourbon business, while Turkey, Woodford Reserve, and Maker's Mark all boast their own bourbon family dynasties, all competing to put out the best products. Sometimes, members of America's bourbon families work across brands, as is the case with Kentucky-based distillery, Heaven Hill.
My name is Max Shapiro, and I'm executive chairman of Heaven Hill Brands. Company was founded in 1935. My dad, hard worker, came out and hired some great people, including one of the members of the Beam Distilling family, who became our master distiller. And the whiskey started to be made.
Every bourbon family has a slightly different story, but they're all in the same game and all concentrated in the same state. It's a small yet fiercely competitive industry.
That we're really not selling cookies and ice cream. We all recognize that this is a very unique and unusual product. You might laugh when I say this. We may kill somebody to sell that last 50 ml in a small store.
A lot of families were touching bourbon, and it wasn't the big industry.
A small industry with big personalities and strong family ties makes a recipe for competition.
Well, my grandfather, which is a brother to Jim Beam, his name was William Parker. Well, they've always been very competitive for trying to produce the best quality products.
I think we're all competitive and want to push back and make sure we don't go away and we flourish.
As well as competing with each other, bourbon families also have to compete with other popular spirits and fight changing consumer tastes. In the 1970s, after decades of growth, sales begin to flounder. Bourbon, perceived as a drink for old men, is out.
The younger people, they just go for lighter stuff. They go for lighter flavors and things is what they're doing.
Consumer tastes started to change. The rise of the Moscow Mule drink in California, which was made with vodka, gin martinis became the thing.
Distilleries tried desperately to come up with a solution, innovating with mixed drinks, weaker whiskey, and even clear bourbon. The economic impact in Kentucky of bourbon's fall from grace is massive.
We've got the second highest unemployment in the United States today. That's terrible.
April 30th will be the last day for workers at this barrel manufacturing plant who will be laid off permanently.
Everybody's getting laid off. It's nothing to be helped about it.
Just when bourbon is looking down the barrel of doom, the ingenuity of a few master distillers changes the tide.
We had a fabulous discovery. We started with single barrel products, small batch whiskeys, whiskeys with unique mash bills, recipes in effect, different alcohol strengths, extra age characteristics.
The small batches elevate the status and exclusivity of bourbon, giving the drink a slick rebrand.
That all of a sudden, a younger group of consumers were interested in discovering something different, unique, and out of the ordinary that was really a part of America.
Mixologists popularized a variety of bourbon-based cocktails, including the Old Fashioned, the Manhattan, and the Mint Julep. The bourbon renaissance is in full swing. The distilleries ride the high into the 1990s. But a storm is brewing. Just around the corner, the bourbon business would experience its worst disaster of modern times, a tragedy that would shake the industry to its core and test the limits of family ties.
Well, you could feel the heat from up here from those major White Houses.
It was a fire rain.
It was awful.
Just like somebody just pulled your part of your life away. It's gone.
By the early 1990s, America's native spirit, bourbon, is rebounding from a period of decline. The family dynasties of Kentucky begin again to rise. Orders are rolling in, especially from Japan, where consumers seek an authentic American experience.
This home of bourbon whiskey, Heaven Hill Distilleries, is expanding its operation because of increasing sales. Today, the distillery broke ground for a $3 million expansion that will create 30 additional jobs.
The liquor is flowing and business is back. This means big orders, more barrels, and lots of aging bourbon. The second largest store of bourbon in the world is located at Heaven Hills Warehouses in Kentucky. The yeast used to brew the popular brand dates back seven generations to a Beam Dynasty original batch. Over at Jim Beam, their bourbon is the best selling in the world. In 1991, they sell almost 21 million cases of bourbon. For a small state, that is a lot of alcohol production. In fact, in Kentucky, there are more barrels of aging bourbon than people. Just as the industry is getting back on its feet, on November 7th, 1996, disaster strikes.
Well, I can remember this all very vividly.
I was here on that day, and it was about 80 degrees, you know, which is kind of unusual for that time of year.
It was a gloomy, dark, cloudy, wind-swept day.
We're talking about some severe weather coming in that late that afternoon.
At Heaven Hill's massive warehouses, winds clock at 70 miles per hour.
I believe it's probably around 1:40 in the afternoon. I remember seeing the clock stop when the power went off. I was down at the old distillery in the office, and then I heard somebody say the warehouse is on fire up here on the hill. So I stepped out of the office, ran out of the office, and looked up, and I could see flames shooting out of the window.
Parker and distillery supervisor Charlie Downs drive up the hill to investigate, and what they see immediately triggers a full-scale evacuation.
Just sit back and watch it unfold, and just kind of felt helpless, you know.
And it just didn't take very long to see the first warehouse engulfed in flames.
No Halloween fright could ever equal this real-life nightmare. Family members and neighbors struggled to save what they could. Firefighters are dwarfed by the wall of flames. Fire and rain, too much of one and not enough of the other. Throw in wind and thousands of barrels of bourbon, and there's little anyone can do.
I have never seen anything this big.
I've never seen anything like it. It's unreal.
So they're evacuating y'all now?
Yeah.
Valuables and antiques are moved out before the fire can move in.
Oh my, you wouldn't believe it. It was a fireball. You could feel the heat from up here from those major warehouses.
It was a fire and rain.
It was awful.
Heaven Hill's bourbon is stored across dozens of warehouses. One by one, flames begin to swallow them.
It's kind of like a domino effect. Then when the first one collapsed, all the burning alcohol went down the hill and surrounded other warehouses. And then, of course, the distillery was all at the bottom.
Weather conditions couldn't have been any worse. The rain kept coming down, and the wind acted like a blowtorch.
We saw pieces of roofs being lifted into the air and blown 300 feet.
The flaming alcohol creates a river of burning bourbon.
Then it happens. Supports holding back thousands of gallons of whiskey give way. The wall of fire becomes a river of fire.
And when we saw the racks, they call them ricks, collapse and the whiskey start to pour over the hill, and once it ran across the highway, we knew it was going to go.
More barrels explode. More whiskey flows into the 18-inch deep river heading downhill, spilling into the highway as it rages towards the main production plant.
All anyone can do is watch, wait, and wonder what this fire means for Heaven Hill and the small community that's made a way of life from the bourbon burning in its warehouses.
Firefighters aren't sure how it all started, or for that matter, when it will all stop.
Finally, around 7 hours after it started, a sudden change of wind helps calm the fire it stoked. What remains is devastation.
This is what it looks like from the sky today. Black patches where warehouses once stood. Closer, you can see flowing creeks of bourbon, skeletons of cars, melted mailboxes from nearby homes left untouched by the fire. The flames are still going, and the heat is still so intense it has turned pieces of metal bright orange.
They found debris 2 and 3 and 4 miles from here, all over town.
Today, as the shock wears off and the reality of the blaze sets in, those who call this community home begin to cope with what's happened.
The fire wiped out 15% of Heaven Hill's storage capacity. The loss of bourbon and warehouses totals a whopping $30 million.
The flames of doubt and anxiety burn bright in some workers' minds, like Carl Riggs, who had a sleepless night.
We wonder if we're going to have a job, all of us are, imagine.
Riggs was one of the distillery workers who escaped a river of hot blue burning lava that torched their building.
Whiskey just come down there behind me, burnt, singed my eyebrow and my hand, Everybody just had to get out. I mean, he was gone.
He decided it was time to run when he nearly burned his hand as he touched this pickup truck. He cannot believe what he sees now.
You know, it's just like somebody just pulled your part of your life away. It's gone.
If as much bourbon has gone up in flames as we can see on TV here, it could hurt business pretty good, not just in the state of Kentucky, but, you know, nationally.
Miraculously, no one at the distillery is hurt or killed. And one particularly special item is saved from the flames.
Well, the yeast was saved.
The Beam family yeast, dating back generations.
Several days after that, it went through the wind and got the jug yeast out and brought it out and put it in a local liquor store here in the cooler box till we found something else to do with it.
But even though the yeast survives, the Heaven Hill Distillery, one of the state's largest plants, is facing an uncertain future. As ash settles, investigators enter the scene to pick through the wreckage and uncover the cause of the blaze.
And what they're finding is almost scorched beyond recognition.
This is an unusual fire. It's the first time we've ever been on this type where there's, I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of gallons of flammables.
Agents are also searching memories across town as they interview dozens of firefighters and distillery workers behind closed doors. Do you have any reason at this point to suspect foul play?
None whatsoever. No.
But that hasn't been eliminated as a possibility.
Oh, there's nothing's been eliminated at this point.
Investigators want to look closely at how the electrical wiring was burned. That, they say, will tell them a lot.
As agents look for clues, others in the bourbon industry get wind of the tragedy.
Well, I remember where I was, just like when John Kennedy was shot. I was in Budapest, and the Heaven Hill story was big news.
I got a fax. I was in a hotel room. The fax slid under the door. Heaven Hill is burning down. Like, what?
The Heaven Hill fire is the worst distillery fire to ever hit the industry. To this day, it remains the worst ever in the United States. 2% of the world's whiskey simply evaporates. Now it's sink or swim for Heaven Hill. And its competitors have a choice. Lend a hand or let them burn.
The warehouse where the fire began stood here. It was 7 stories high. And after the fire, all that was left was a pile of rubble, waste high.
Ultimately, we lost about 100,000 barrels of whiskey and several warehouses, but our distillery production facility as well. It was a dramatically impactful day that we had.
The damage looks bleak for Heaven Hill. The fire eliminates a huge share of Heaven Hill's inventory. 92,000 barrels of bourbon, 7.7 million gallons gone. The total cost of the loss, $30 million. To this day, the source of the fire remains a mystery. The fire has scorched all evidence. The Heaven Hill family is facing one of the worst tragedies to ever hit the industry. They don't expect what happens next.
I remember getting on the phone and calling Max and asking what he needed.
Anything we can do to help you, let us know. We'll be there. And storage space or whatever you need.
Very quickly, several of our competitors called us and said, we know what's happened. We're willing to make some whiskey for you using your formula, using your recipe, letting your master distillers come over and plant a watchful eye.
In an industry where every barrel of bourbon matters, the competition lays aside their ambitions to help Heaven Hill recover.
The bourbon industry in Kentucky really is a fraternity. We all share greatly with the loss that's been suffered here. We wouldn't even dream of gloating over a loss.
I don't know that there's many other industries in the entire world that would have done something like that.
The bourbon dynasties come together, choosing generosity and compassion over competition. Almost 30 years after the fire, the bourbon industry is in full swing and experiencing a boom to the tune of $9 billion. Today, a new generation of bourbon leaders is paving the way, some with family ties, but most without. Marianne Eaves is Kentucky's first female master distiller. Marianne is a part of a new wave of bourbon connoisseurs entering the industry, despite not sharing a last name with some of the industry's large families. Between 2009 and 2021, the number of distilleries in the state increased fivefold, mostly due to the growth of craft distilleries.
We are Kentucky's first and only African-American distillery.
We are so excited to be a part of our local bourbon industry and the local bourbon culture.
Those are almost all individuals who are passionately interested in their own companies, and they develop some interesting, unique kinds of products. That has been a really helpful thing for the entire bourbon category. Many are competitors of ours, of course, but they've added some great vitality to the overall bourbon business.
Through prohibition and changing consumer trends, disastrous fires, and new competition, Kentucky bourbon kings and queens continue their reign as one of America's top spirit manufacturers. And the spirit of collaboration shared by the industry isn't going away.
It's cooperation instead of cutthroat competition that makes the whiskey business so unique. These companies genuinely care about each other.
And we're all friends, and we greet each other in a most cordial way. And it's almost like we're all in this together. We are all walking down the same path, arm in arm.